twist. So there's going to be an assortment of music today. This tune is called Closing, but it's opening. Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle. Zenobia here, the Touchable Tech Diva. Welcome to this Wednesday midday, most places on the globe. Enjoy. I'll be back in just a bit.
Thank you.
Zenobia here. Welcome again. Happy Wednesday, middle of the weekday. Some people call it hump day. Anyway, I'm glad to have you here. So this is your time to take off a couple of hours. Oh, that's my alarm on my phone. Anyway, take off a couple of hours and listen to some cool music. And yeah, there's all this hot chatter about Apple from their big rollout yesterday. So I'm going to talk about some of that today because that watch is completely astounding. So I can't help but talk about that today. But I talked about the rollout a couple of weeks ago because the cat was out of the bag. So many people already knew that they were going to do this press conference yesterday. And I've got some other things to talk about. Coming up with the what's that. I was a little busy, so I didn't really get to a what's that. But I think I have a good what's that for you in light of holiday buying and buying anytime online. Some pointers to just get us in the spirit. So you're here, Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle Show here on Internet Television. We get to do whatever we want on Internet Television. We're not restricted like broadcast over the air or wired cable networks are. And so that gives me a lot of freedom to do all kinds of things. So anyway, you're here, and in the last couple of weeks, I've talked about the QR code that I put together, so Chris is going to put the QR code up. If you're here live, then you already know you're here at RMC On Air Live. On air. See, I still have that on air live business. RMC On Air. That's why I did the QR code, so I can't mess that up. It's in the code, and you get to scan it with your smartphone and get it right. Go right to the right place. Anyway, so he's putting up the code. And that's an opportunity for you to get a lot of information about how to see the show live and as well playback. And there it is. Okay, so what you do, if you have a smartphone, your homework, maybe I didn't give you the homework, but you were to download a QR code generator scanner. Okay, so you've had a couple of weeks to do that. Come on, get with the program. Download one onto your smartphone. I'm talking to smartphone people right now. Whether it be an Android, a BlackBerry, a Windows, or an iPhone. And you hold that code up to your monitor and you scan it. Okay, and then you say yes because it will open up the website page that has all of the ways that you can, well, just about all. There are going to be a couple of new ones coming along. Several ways that you can catch the show on replay. So I'll mouth them very quickly, but do that QR code. Very cool. If you want me to email the code to you, email me at tdll@att.net. That's actually on that page as well. And you can, anyway, I'm not going to go through all of that. That was the point behind doing the website page. But at some point in time, I will give you the address to the QR code page and you can catch everything. So I'll do that in one of the next couple of sections of the show. Okay, lots of stuff. I'm going to play some more music right now. And oh, let me tell you who you just heard in our first opening set. The last tune you heard was called Parlor Phone, and that was by Terje Lee from an album called Urban Vacation. And right in the middle was Slap Happy. Why is that Slap Happy? That's a Slap Happy guitar there. Brian Bromberg. And the CD is called It Is What It Is. And opening up our set was a tune called Closing, which I love that tune. I love all my music because this is what I listen to all the time. I don't listen to LA radio. Okay, LA radio has nothing to energize me. My playlist on my phone, I play in my car constantly, or I do Pandora. Okay, so opening up the set was Closing by Terry Silverlight from a CD called Wild. Okay, Zenobia here, the Touchable Tech Diva. I got some tech tools and some tech news you can use, some hot, hot jazz, and a little bit of luxury lifestyle stuff today. Enjoy, I'll be back in a little bit.
Oh,
Hello, I'm back. Zenobia here, tech diva and the luxury lifestyle, doing your Wednesday up today, the middle of your week, wherever you are in the globe. Okay, you just heard Saxophonic, come on up, Dave Koz. Saxophonic is the album. Prior to that, Kicking It Up, and that's Gerald Albright. And that's from an album called Kicking It Up. Okay, here's a bit of history. This goes back to the early 80s. This is a little history about me, a microbio. But I've been involved in entertainment and technologies for 30 years, a long, long time, since the 80s. And I decided that I'll be a recording engineer. And I went around and I went to a bunch of different recording studios and Audio Engineering Associates in Pasadena, California. This is a big plug for Wes Dooley. Actually took me in as an unknowing. And he and Ron Stryker, I'm dropping name dropping. Ron Stryker taught me how to record using real microphones. I'm like the last recording engineer to use like real microphones on everything. It was just prior to MIDI coming. And they took me in. They taught me how to do location recording, how to set up a recording studio on location. So that was to take the mixers and the reel-to-reel tape recorders and a whole kit of microphones, another kit of cables, and have to run cables wherever we were, and to do a first-rate, top-notch recording live. Well, sometimes we did it live for broadcast, but mostly we put it in the can, and then we would go back and edit it. Anyway, they were very instrumental and very much involved with the Audio Engineering Society, which is an international audio organization, very big, and it is known for standards in recording and audio manufacturing setting. That's the place where you would go to the Audio Engineering Society if you had a new audio patent, or you had a new process for manufacturing any kind of audio equipment. Anyway, I was involved with that. They got me involved in going to the Audio Engineering Society meetings. And they would have, very rarely would they have their convention in Los Angeles. And I recall a time where I had gone to a convention in New York, and I said, well, gee, they have all these events and they have no live music at their, you know, the after events, at the close of the convention day, they'd have these get-togethers and there was no music. And I'm like, how can this be an audio society and not have any live music anywhere? So the opportunity came up for me to, well, when the convention came to Los Angeles, and I immediately jumped on the convention committee because I wanted to see the society have real live music there. They had every speaker manufacturer on the planet that would come to the convention. They would have every console manufacturer, that every microphone. That was the place to be if you had products that you wanted the audio world to see or hear. Okay, it was mostly see, except on the convention floor, but there weren't many opportunities to hear. So what I did, being on the committee and being privy to access to all kinds of people, I pulled together an evening of live music to do a live concert at the Audio Engineering Society. And I called upon some of my clients, who included Patrice Rushen, Munyongo Jackson, and who you just heard, Gerald Albright. And they said, well, yeah, we'll do it for you. And that was so successful. People were so surprised. People came from everywhere for that evening of live jazz. It started out actually in a small room because they didn't, it was just like a side thing. So they said, oh yeah, just give her a room. So they gave me a room, could fit 100 people. And the room filled up and we had just a wonderful evening of live music. And JBL supplied the speakers. I think I got a Soundcraft console. I got all kinds of cool stuff, and it was just wonderful. And that was the very first start of live concerts at the Audio Engineering Society. And today, the concerts, when the manufacturers, I think JBL may still do a concert, they just huge numbers of people in a big hall, in a big theater or auditorium. So I'm happy to say that I was the catalyst to get live music at the Audio Engineering Society conventions. Okay, so that's kind of a roundabout way to tie into Gerald Albright, who is a fabulous, fabulous sax player. And maybe one of these days I'll get that group back together, resurrected here on a show. Okay, then opening up the set was David Benoit, keyboardist extraordinaire, doing a cover of Watermelon Man. I know folks can, it's a really recognizable tune, very cool, and the CD is called Right Here, Right Now. Okay, a little short set. I know I've been talking a lot. I got a lot to talk about today, actually, and I just came up with a What's That, so it's going to be an introduction that I'm not going to do right this second. When I come back, I'll be doing the What's That. But I just have to talk a little bit about updating you about my homework. I did my homework, and I went to hear live music. I did last Wednesday, actually right after the show. Oh, here's my notes. Right after I did the show, I went and I paid for tickets. I didn't do my press thing this time. But I paid for tickets to the Hollywood Bowl, to the Academy Celebrates the Black Movie soundtrack. And I think I had mentioned to you that Marcus Miller was the musical director for the evening. And he was there with the space, his typical look. And Reginald Hudlin, I think he curated the movies that were selected for the Hollywood Bowl Orchestra. It was about a 40-piece orchestra, a sizable orchestra, it wasn't a small orchestra. And it was fabulous. It was just fabulous. So I think I mentioned to you some of the artists that were there, and some I had not heard live before, so it was a first for me. Well, let me tell you that some of the movies that they did were Stormy Weather. So they showed a track of Cab Calloway leading the band. And that was a playback. And I don't remember, I was so involved with watching the video on the big screens. They have new big screens all around the amphitheater. And I was just so engaged in watching Stormy Weather and just going back in time that I didn't notice if the orchestra was actually playing along, which they did do on a couple of tunes. So Stormy Weather, that was really cool. And of course, Superfly. Had to do Superfly. And The Bodyguard. So The Bodyguard, when they did that piece, they actually did it from the 1920s, 30s, all the way through to today. So they picked films that were in each decade or in each time period, which actually was a really cool thing to do. Anyway, I'm jumping ahead to The Bodyguard. So when they had The Bodyguard piece, they actually played Whitney's voice. But the orchestra, you could hear the orchestra. The orchestra was playing the track. So they had her voice tracked to the orchestra, which was really cool. And that, of course, was synced to the film. And so that was really amazing. En Vogue was there. They did a live piece. They're still gorgeous. And they had on these gorgeous red dresses. Red's my favorite color, by the way. just really stunning. It got really quiet when they walked out on the stage because all the guys were gaga. You could see all the guys in the audience were just, their eyes were glued. Anyway, even my friend was talking up a blue streak about how good they look. Anyway, so they did a piece there. That was really cool. And there was another culture. Oh, Bilal was there. He's a songster. And he has a fabulous voice. I've not ever seen him perform live, but it was very cool. He and Anthony Hamilton just were just amazing. So go check out some of their stuff. They did some really cool stuff. Really cool stuff. I actually got some pieces of video, but I took it off the screen, so it's not all that great. But I may put them up on the YouTube channel just so you can get a flavor for what was going on. So anyway, that's a taste of how I did my homework. So hopefully you will have done yours, and you can post some comments on the YouTube channel. That's on the QR code page. Okay, so I want everybody to get that QR code page. And we're actually, Chris is going to put up the URL to go to the page in case you don't have a smartphone or you don't have a scanner yet. And that is MediaTech, T-E-C-H, marketplace.com/. And you have to do all capitals, TDLL.htm. Don't leave out the .htm or else you won't get there. It won't work. So it's MediaTechMarketplace.com/TDLL.htm. And that is the page that the QR code takes you to. So if you don't have the code, there's the URL. And you can go there, and the page will give you the URL to rmconair.com and to the show's website, as well as to the show's YouTube channel. So this is a model show for exploring and bringing all of the ways that you can view a set of content or a show in different ways and on different devices. I'm a huge advocate of that. I tell my clients all the time, okay, you just can't have a website page anymore. And if you do have your website page, you need to make it mobile friendly, because I will tell you in a second, I can't see your page on my phone, especially if it's all flash. That era has gone. Everybody release your all-flash pages, and you got to transfer over to HTML5 because that can be viewed on all devices. That's a whole nother topic. Okay, so I want to play some more music. I always have way more music than I have show. But a couple of really cool things. Oh, in terms of events that are coming up, I wanted to just front load you on an event that I got a special golden ticket to. It's in November, and it's being sponsored by the Be Great Festival. The Be Great Partners are doing what's called the Be Great Fest 2014, and it is this is the second year that they're doing it. And what it is it's an organization that celebrates entrepreneurship. So I bring this up because it's not only about technology, but it's about passionate living and people living their passion through their companies. And so that all fits in with our passionate living theme and with our technology. So that's going to touch a lot of areas. Anyway, that's in November, so that's a little ways out. But they have what's called a startup village, and that is host to a lot of different startups. They have all kinds of keynote addresses. There's going to be over 5,000 people at this. So 2,000 of the tickets got sold within 12 hours of the announcement. So it's the hot place to be. It's going to be a really hot, hot place to be. And the party is supposed to be outstanding, I understand. But I'm going, and I think it'll be just a great opportunity to be able to catch some video. I'm getting permissions right now. I'm getting the permission to video and some segments for my show, for the show here. So you'll get to have a perspective on that particular event via video. And I'm also looking at some other things having to do that. But I think that's going to be a nice event. I've not gone before, and I was really thrilled and appreciative to get a comp golden ticket. I got a golden ticket, which is, I think, the second highest ticket, because the tickets are very expensive. So that's going to be a really fun thing. Okay, real quick before I get into some more music, I'm just going to touch on these things, but of course, Apple is in the atmosphere, in the Kool-Aid, in the water, everywhere, from their big announcement, which was yesterday, which I talked about on my show a couple of weeks ago, or was it last week? Maybe it was last week. I forget. Do you remember, Chris? Chris is not helpful on that today. Anyway, so it was either last week or the week before that authorities who could not be named had talked about the iPhone 6 coming and the iPads, larger sizes. Well, that actually happened yesterday, where they had the big unveiling. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it right now, but I just have to tell you that that Apple Watch is over the top. That Apple Watch is over the top. So there's a lot of these watches that are out that are Android or open source watches. One of my clients has, there's a guy who works for one of my clients there, and he's walking around with his little watch that he's doing his email on. This Apple Watch blows away everything. Blows away everything. I haven't checked the prices. I would be amazed. I think I'm going to be amazed at the price. I think Chris mentioned some prices, but I'm going to look those up. But I want to do a whole show on the concept behind these new iWatches. I'll call them iWatches for lack of a better term, because it all kind of falls in the scheme of access outside of traditional computers. Computer forms, the platform, and phone platforms, and it's called the wearable technology. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time today, but the whole wearable technology thing is going crazy. Between wearable technology and 3D printing, that's got the world all abuzz. So I just wanted to mention, and you can go take a sneak peek. Well, it's not a sneak peek anymore, but if you go to apple.com, when they do big releases like that, they put the product on their homepage. I love that idea. So you can go and you can watch the video on the Apple Watch. At the same time yesterday, so Apple continues to be creative with their innovations, and they make moves that people wonder, oh, well, why are they doing that? For instance, when they bought Beats, okay, Beats, you know, the headphones, $500, however much they cost headphones, when they bought Beats, there is a particular reason for that. That is starting to percolate through and become clear. So that's hardware. On the software level, so they bought into some music hardware. Now, yesterday was revealed their software alliance with U2. Okay, I love jazz. I'm from San Francisco. I'm a native San Franciscan, when the roots of rock were planted. So I'm a rocker also. I'm a classic rock girl too. Because I grew up, you know, I was in high school when the rock era started to get its wings. So I still have an affection for rock music, and U2. In particular, Bono of U2, he I like a lot of the things that he's doing on a global level as a corporate citizen. And one of my bucket list items was actually to take off and stop everything and be gone for a year and work with a major NGO that's a non-governmental organization, nonprofit, and go work for a year and go to some distant land and use my skills and my knowledge of technology to make the world better. And so I kind of watch what you two and what Bono is doing. And so I have some ideas about that. Anyway, getting back to Apple, they teamed up together and Bono, YouTube was releasing a new album. Okay, and it is called Songs of Innocence. So in their partnering up with Apple, what did they do? They gave away the album for free to everyone who has an iTunes account. Okay, and how they did it was, this is amazing. This is just a jaw dropper for me. This is where they are, that they can give away for free a half a billion copies of not one song, but the whole album as a download. So if you have iTunes, it's already in your iCloud music account. Okay, the whole album, the I think it's 11 songs. I saw that in an email. I think I was in the bed yesterday morning and I was just going through stuff and I came across this at like 6 in the morning and I was still kind of groggy and I'm like, oh my goodness, I'm going to try this out and see if this is for real, because if it is, the internet should be jammed and I won't be able to get it and I'll miss out. Because I didn't really understand the fact that it was for everybody who had an iTunes account to get it, was already there. This is like astounding. This is where technology gets us now. And lo and behold, I opened up my iTunes and I did a search on, I went to the iTunes store and did a search on YouTube. And there was this message that says that it's already in your iTunes account. All you have to do is hit download. And in less than 5 minutes, of course, it was downloaded into my music library on my iTunes account. So check it out. See if you can still do that. If you have an iTunes account, then you go to the store. And you may not even be able to go to the store. I just wasn't really a believer, but now I am. But go to the store, search YouTube if you like YouTube's music. I did it more just to check out the technology, but I do like some of the YouTube's tracks. I do. I really do. I like their stuff. And download it, and you get a free download, because this is not hitting the streets until October, I believe, until the middle of October. So if ever you want a chance to get something free from iTunes and from Apple, go get that, if nothing else, because there is no cost, no charge. Okay, so yeah, so I got the email here. And no, actually, I think I downloaded this actually, it was from somebody else's site, but it says, just go to the purchase section of the iTunes store app on your phone, or in the iTunes store on your computer, and it should be there. And then you just hit download. Okay? Da 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 da. There you go. So that's a little jewel for you. Okay, let's play some more music. I got a couple of other things and more news and just a really quick what's that. And yeah, all kinds of stuff today. I'm going to talk a little bit about electronic payments and get you ready for the holidays. And we've been talking about mobile security and stuff like that. So there's some things I can tell you about that. Okay, Zenobia, the touchable tech diva. Yes, I'm making this technology touchable in your life and making your life more efficient so that you can have more time to do your passion. Tech diva and the luxury lifestyle, tech tools, toys, and news, hot jazz, passionate living. See you in a bit. know, a little change in the mood of the music. Settle down. We were hot and heavy. Now we're settling down a little bit. Okay, Zenobia here, the Touchable Tech Diva, bringing you a tune called Wish You Were Here, and that's Foreplay from their, I think, the first album that they did together. Let me see if I can recall. Harvey Mason on drums, Nathan East on bass, and Larry Carlton or Lee Ritenour on guitar, and Bob James on keyboards. Don't quote me 100%, but I think I got it right. Very close, at least. Anyway, Foreplay. And and that came about. They're all really, really great studio musicians. I got so much history. Studio musicians who finally decided to get together and do something together. And that was Foreplay. Okay, prior to that, Go With The Flow, and that was Walter Beasley. And that was from an album, the same name, Go With The Flow. And opening up the set was Ronnie Jordan with After Eight, and from a CD of the same title. What's That? Okay, today's What's That is just an introduction, because I will do a full show on this particular topic, and it is electronic payments. Okay, so What's That is electronic payments, and it's the PayPal style of electronic payments, which I'm going to talk about a little bit today. I've been involved with this stuff so long, I don't need any notes today. I got this. Anyway, so electronic payments are payments that you make over the computer. You know, you can do them over the phone, but we're not dealing with the phone ones today. We're doing the ones that you use over the computer. And this particular type of electronic payment that I'm going to talk about are the ones that you use them and your banking information, your credit card information, is not exposed to the vendor. Okay, there are, as I mentioned, all kinds of ways to do electronic payments online. And now you can do them on your phone. So let's just stick generically to start with. Once the banking industry was an advocate of doing online banking, that was a cue to me that the internet could be used in an absolute secure way. Because at first I was like, oh, this whole internet thing and the whole security thing, nah, they can't possibly get it right. But then when I saw the banking industry converting, then I knew that they had mandates for the internet backbone, that is the whole transportation system for the internet. That's that network of servers all across the globe. With their mandates for it to be secure, that it was gonna probably be okay. I was rolling with the banks, because the banks have a whole lot more at stake than I do. And for them to get the security game right was very big, because it's not only about us peons, but multinational companies, and the whole banking structure was able to do what they do via computer internet access. So I thought, well, okay, so that's got to be pretty soon. And they're going to come up with schemes that will keep monetary transactions secure. So we fast forward to today, and as an outgrowth of that, you have companies like PayPal, and there are other companies, you know, entrepreneurs. All of this computer data is really zeros and ones. It's programming. So once you get good programmers, then you can design these applications. You can come up with, that's why we have VCs, venture capitalists, make so much money in the 90s, in the late 90s with the dot-com boom, because so many products were coming up and concepts and features that could be done that were a big help to us, actually, big help. Anyway, so now we have the banks that now they'll charge you if you go see a teller. That's how into moving you to the online environment they are. And then some other, like some of the utilities, will charge you extra. It's working out really weird. If you don't do your transactions online. And then, of course, some companies are still trying to charge for you to pay online. But we get to PayPal, so we see the advent of companies like eBay and people wanting to sell, all kinds of businesses wanting to sell their goods on the internet. And the cost of doing that and setting that up tended to be pretty prohibitive. So some very smart people got together. A lot of them came out of the universities where these guys were going to college, and they were just think tanks in their bedrooms, in their dorm rooms, and they came up with these concepts. So PayPal, I'm using PayPal as an example, was just one of those. And the concept behind PayPal is that you want to do purchase products, or you want to send money to someone, but you don't want to expose your personal information, you know, for instance, like your social security number or any of that information, or your banking information. So they came up with a clever idea to be able to be the intermediaries between you and the vendor. So they would shore up their security where you would register with PayPal. And you would register your banking or your credit card information, and that would be on repository with PayPal. And on the vendor side, you could go to a vendor's website and make a purchase and not expose your personal banking information or your credit card information to that vendor and make the purchase. And here I'll use eBay as an example. Well, eBay actually bought PayPal. If you didn't know that, eBay owns PayPal. That's how big this was for them. eBay, which was the auction site where you can auction, you can sell your stuff or you buy stuff, eBay was a big proponent of using PayPal, and a lot of the sellers on eBay will only use PayPal because sellers then do not see your credit card information. They do not see your banking information, yet they will facilitate, they'll take your purchase, but make the transaction, the money part of it, happen via PayPal. So they would send you off to PayPal, and PayPal was verified, had verified your information, and your banking and your credit card information was verified, so a seller could be assured that your banking and your financial information was good enough to get the transaction done. And then once PayPal processed that transaction by either deducting it from that amount from your bank account or from your credit card, and then verifying that, once that amount was verified, then they would send it back to the vendor saying, okay, this purchaser, this buyer is fine, their money's good, you can go on and send them their goods. Okay, so that's a PayPal, because I've run into people who says, oh no, I'm not doing any kind of buying or paying bills on the computer or on the internet. And I tell you, the amount of purchases that happen on the internet, especially around the holiday times, is exponential. It's a multi-billion dollar industry that shifted the whole financial structure of this country, of the world, actually, because PayPal is global. It's a global company. And so you can buy things through PayPal, and PayPal will do all the money conversion and all of that. That's what they do. So you can buy something on eBay, for instance, from a seller who is in another, on another continent, and PayPal will handle that transaction and do all the monetary monetary conversions and take the funds out of your account wherever you are in the world. So I bring this up because the holidays are coming, and a lot of people, as I mentioned, are concerned about the security. And I'm not sure, you can't quote me, but I think that PayPal's encryption is layered. There's layers of encryption there. And so it's a high-grade encryption system to encrypt the transactions, the money, the monetary transactions, and the transfer of the funds. And in a way, it's all paper, except for the bank accounts. I mean, it's real money that comes out of your account. You put real money into your account. And then after that, yeah, eventually ends up being a real money transaction through the banks. But it's all paper. It's a paper transaction. But you want to keep your information as secure as you can. So I just used eBay and PayPal as an example of a what's that, because there are people that say, well, what's that? How does that work? How do I know that my my money is secure? So this is one component. There are other companies that do these same kinds of transactions. One that you may or may not have heard of is called SquareUp. And Square, oh, I should have my little Square gadget. SquareUp is doing transactions as well. What they're doing is they took the whole online transaction payment to mobile with a little Square thing. Oh, I'm going to duck down for just a second so I can grab my Square. It's in the girl purse, but I'll get it. So what they've done is they've taken the whole monetary payment onto the mobile device. I have to show it to you after the break, because the girl purse will take a little while. With a card reader, a credit card scanner, we've been talking scanners here, that gets put into your cell phone. It's a little Square. Well, they're all different. The SquareUp is now not only the only company, but it's a little Square that goes into your headphone jack of your smartphone, and it has a little slit. So with the right app on your phone, you can now have your card scanned. Okay, and the transaction shows up here, okay, on your phone. So that's like if you want to do in-person purchases, like if you go to the coffee shop or you go anywhere, it's becoming very, very pervasive where you can actually take that and do the transaction with a vendor who has a smartphone and now an iPad. I just went through the process of setting up my church. I've brought my church into the digital business 2.0. That's my phrase. I coined digital business 2.0 world, to where they can now take their tithes and their offerings and pay for event tickets using, I'm using Square. We set up Square. So we actually got the iPad and we got a Square stand that has the card scanner on it. But we also have the little Square. So just in case we can be at an event and people want to buy tickets, we just take the little iPad. There's no power. You run it off the battery. Long battery life. And so people can make purchases to the church using the Square. So I bring Square up and how they pushed a concept that PayPal kind of pioneered. They weren't the only ones, but they established their footprint in the market, and so people know their name a lot more than others, because now Square, because they we're one of the early ones to get payments transacted via cell phone. they pushed everybody. So now PayPal has a little device that you can get for free. Okay, there's no charge for the device because they're going to make their money off of the fee that they charge, off the percentage that they charge. Okay, so now both PayPal and Square have pushed the banking industry to now have credit card readers for mobile, because they were seeing that companies like PayPal and Square were taking away from their merchant accounts. And if you had a merchant account where you wanted to take credit cards in your store when people came in, or at events, you would have to get this device to swipe your card. Everybody, you all must be familiar with those, where they swipe your card and you do the transaction that way. And at the end of the day, you know, the merchant reconciles their account, and then the money that they got that day wouldn't appear in their bank account for 3 or 4 or 5 days. With Square Up and PayPal, it shows like the next day. That put a lot of heat on the banking industry to step up their game, because people were not signing up for merchant accounts. I didn't. I got rid of my merchant account when I got stung by the bank for $3,600 because of a bad transaction that they approved. So I got the Square immediately when I saw the Square. I got the Square because automatically that increased my business, because I could now take people's credit cards to buy gear from me. And so now the banking industry, they're offering it, but they're still charging some fees. And there is a fee that the seller or the vendor has to pay. Typically, though, with the Square and the PayPal, it's less than what the banks are charging. So the banks are kind of rolling up to, so that leapfrog where they have to, you know, well, leap down, because now the fees are getting lower for merchants to be able to take credit cards. So it's a convenience, and it's great for merchants on the merchant side, because that expands our ability to service more customers. Because when's the last time you ordered checks? I've been out of checks now for my business, because I don't take checks for my business most of the time, for probably 9 months now. And for my personal bank account, I haven't reordered checks, and so I've been without checks for about 4 months, and I am no worse for wear for not ordering checks again. Okay, because everything I do is with a debit card or online. So there is a convenience to us. There's a convenience to vendors, because they can make more money. The convenience for us is because those of us who don't carry a lot of cash or checks, we can still get what we want. Okay, so that's today's What's That? Electronic payments via smartphone and via computer, via PayPal style electronic payment systems. Okay, if you have any questions and you wanted to know something about how that really works still, then email me at tdll@att.net. That's tdll@att.net. Or you can leave a message on Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle's website, which is touchabletechdiva.ning.com. Okay, and if you saw the website for the QR code, if you're on your computer, you can go straight to that website. And it will have the email, it'll have the show's website, it'll have all of that information right there, and a bit about what I do. Okay, very cool. What's That? All right, well, let's do some more music. And again, I have more music left over than I have show, but we're going to do some more music, and I'm going to come back and tell you about my in-house guest I'm going to have next week. It's a person who's living his passion. And so let's have some music. Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle, Tech Tools and Toys, Hot Jazz, Passionate Living. See you in a bit.
The mood and lingering on the edge of an attitude, I went looking. sugar and grace. She took me to the heat of the groove.
Hello, I'm back. I had to laugh because Chris was getting a bit of exercise coming from way outside. Well, out the door. Anyway, so you just heard Big Sur by David Lance, and that's from The Good Life. And prior to that was Lyle Mays, and the tune was called Before You Go from a CD called Street Dreams. And opening up the set was Misha with a tune called Electrified, and that was from Connected to the Unexpected. Well, okay, so in the background you're hearing Future Shock, Herbie Hancock, Stanley Clarke. I think of Herbie Hancock when I hear this because Stanley played with Herbie. Anyway, I just want to say next week we will have a guest. I got confirmation from Ty Fance. And what I'm doing with the passionate living and the luxury lifestyle part of the show, I'm inviting guests on who are living their passions. Okay, and Ty, he had like a really good gig and he decided to live and do his passion. And Ty Fance is a storyteller and an author. And the name of his book is Off My Head and Over the Fence. And it's an account of different aspects of his life. And it's really interesting. He's a really, really cool, funny guy. And that's Ty. And I thought he was a great example of someone who decided to go out and do their passion. And so that's, and you know, we all take risks. I'm taking a risk doing the show. Not really, because it's my passion. This is my passion. So sometimes when you don't really see the risk part of it, when it's something that you love to do, but you jump out there and you just do it, and the universe will embrace you and will cross you with people who like your passion and are motivation for other people to do their passion. Anyway, so Ty is coming on the show next week, and we just got a few more minutes. Listen to a little bit of Stanley Clarke. I'll be back to close out the show. Zenobia here, Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle, Tech Tools, Toys and News, Hot Jazz, Passionate Living. See you in a bit. We'll be right back. okay, you're released back to whatever you were doing before you watched the show. Anyway, Zenobia here. It's been a lot of fun. Good information, fun information, and hopefully I'm getting you tooled up to get ready for the holiday season. Zenobia here, the Touchable Tech Diva. Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle, Tech Tools, Toys, News, Hot Jazz, Passionate Living, Live It. Okay, I'll see you next time. Be well. Bye.